Welcome to Name and Occupation in Depth. Today is Sunday, March 24th, 2024. Today we are interviewing Robin Hignell. He's a journalist at FaceCulture. Robin.
Thank
Hello,
you,
hello.
first of all, for inviting me. Hi, Andre. It's
Hey,
been a
bud.
while.
Yeah, man. Thanks for coming on. Really appreciate it. We want to pick your brain today.
I hope it's interesting
Absolutely.
enough, the things I have to say.
Yeah, well, yeah, it must be weird. You're on the other side of the coin now. You're always doing the interview. Now you're being interviewed.
Now I have to talk about myself. That's going to be a little bit confronting, I think.
So, how did that happen? How did you get into, I guess it's, you're a journalist for Face Culture.
Yes. So I'm a music journalist, and what I do is I do video interviews with a lot of artists all over the world. Can be from the smallest people who only will release a couple of songs to some of the biggest artists in the world, Dutch or international, doesn't matter. And I kind of rolled into it. Actually, it was recommended by somebody at the university to intern there. I have my education in journalism, so I went. It went great, and then yeah, that's been my life for 10 years now.
The rest is history.
Yeah, it wasn't like I always planned to be working in music. I've always enjoyed music. I have a couple of instruments here and there, but I never thought I'd end up there. I have a degree in American studies, and then I did a master's in journalism as well. So it kind of by accident I got onto the music journalism thing.
Like, where did you grow up in the Netherlands?
Oof. I grew up in a little town called Hengelo. It's in the east of the country. I was born in 1986. I don't know how far you want to go back, but I was
That's
born in 19
I
No, but just a very, very regular upbringing, I think. The only thing that stood out was my dad is from Britain. He's from Birmingham in England, so we always had that kind of connection. We went to see family in England every year, but other than that, I would say it's a very typical Dutch upbringing, just going to school, played basketball a lot, and then went to university basically because that's what you do, right?
In Groningen, right?
In Groningen, and then but it's also one of those things where I grew up, like 80% of the people from my graduating class, they went all to Groningen to study. So it was kind of natural to kind of go there as well. And I didn't know what I wanted to do, and I ended up on American studies because it just sounded interesting.
A great city too. It's a lot of fun.
Oh, definitely.
Yeah, it's got a good vibe. It's one of my favorite cities, for sure.
Yeah, I go back every once in a while because a lot of my friends still live there, and it's great to be back. It's I've lived there too long, I've noticed, because I was a student for about 8 years.
That's
Where are
funny.
you living right now?
I moved back to my hometown. I live in Hengelo again, so that's kind of full circle because after Groningen, then I did the internship, got hired there in 2013. And moved to Amsterdam. So I lived in Amsterdam for about 8 years, and then the whole COVID pandemic started. And I lived with a friend in Hoofddorp, which is close to Schiphol, for a year, but that didn't really work out. And I was paying so much rent in the west of the country that I decided just to move back. My boss was okay with it. He's from my same hometown as well, which is a nice kind of connection. But yeah, I moved back home to my hometown. I can afford an apartment here, so that's kind of why. Yeah,
It's
you do
crazy.
notice it when you live there, that kind of the proper Amsterdam people who've lived there all their lives, they're being pushed to the fringes a little bit, which is kind of sad, but it's understandable as well.
Yeah. It's an international city now.
Yep.
It's changed a lot.
It was great living there. I mean, for somebody who's from a small town, I mean, Amsterdam is a really great, it's still my favorite city in the Netherlands. So
me too, yeah.
It was awesome. But then, yeah, it got a little bit too expensive. And I'm not the most ambitious person, especially financially. So that makes it a little bit more difficult to live there.
Like I noticed, because I watch FaceCulture and I saw that you're able to do now. It's just, it doesn't matter where you are.
Initially, I liked it, the Zoom interviews, and it was purely out of necessity because of the COVID rules. But now I start to dislike it more and more because you do miss that kind of genuine connection of looking somebody in the eye and talking to them. And people are a little bit more distracted, you notice, and the quality is just a little bit less. So that's, I do start to wish for more face-to-face interviews, but that the business has changed, so there aren't that many press days anymore. They've noticed, well, we don't have to fly over every artist to every city in Europe to get some promo done. We can just do a couple through Zoom and
save
have
money.
Some of our own social media teams put some content out, and that's what a lot of artists do now.
Wild, eh?
That's so interesting. It never shifted back.
No, I really expected it would, but and there's some of it still, but it's so much less than it was before.
How's that? So your summers, that's your busy season, is when you're on the road, you're at these festivals and you interview people. Is that right?
Yeah, usually, because during the week you do maybe on average one a day, or sometimes you have a couple on a day, but then some days you don't have any interviews. At festivals, the aim is just simply to do as many as you can, because you're there, all the artists are there. So you want to do as many as you can, and then depending on how many people are going, because we used to have interns. Now, the last kind of 5 years I've been mostly on my own. But we used to have interns, and then you just try to do as many as possible. And a lot of those artists are just waiting backstage anyway. And it's not the rock and roll lifestyle that people imagine backstage. There's just a lot of families, and it's very easy going backstage usually. So they need to kill the time a little bit as well. So during festivals, you get to do a lot. So I've been to Lowlands, North Sea Jazz, Best Kept Secrets, Down the Rabbit Hole, Forta Rock and Metal Festival, many more.
Nice. Wow. How far, what's the furthest that you would go for a festival?
For festival, they've all been in the Netherlands, but I've been...
it's kind of a hot spot, the Netherlands.
Yeah, I mean, so we have so many good festivals here, and a lot of international artists swing by, so we do have a good festival culture here, I would say.
Oh, yeah.
No, but
we need to get a pass.
I don't know if I can still get them, because the last couple of years, the festival's also similar thing. They just don't do as much promo anymore. So that's it's kind of sad. But no, I've been to Germany a couple of times, to Cologne for some metal bands, for Nightwish. They asked me to come there. And I think the furthest I've been was for Good Charlotte, and they asked me to come to Paris and pay the train ticket, so I went to Paris for a day.
Nice. Good guys.
Yeah, I really liked them. But most artists, I would say there's been a few who were kind of assholes, but most of them are pretty good, cool. Usually it's the managers and kind of the people around
entourage.
Them that are annoying and want to have their say in it. But the artists usually are pretty cool, I would say.
Right,
but I've done so many, it's also difficult to remember all of them. Because like you said in the beginning, I have met quite some people, but it's not like you really hang out. It's usually half an hour, you talk to them for half an hour.
It's next.
A little bit of small talk, and then it's over. So the only thing I will say, and if I'm talking too much, just let me know.
No, man.
But the only thing I will say is if you interview the same people or bands over a span of time, and if you interview them a couple of times, sometimes some sort of relationship will develop, and they recognize you, and there's this rapport that starts building.
How much preparation do you do?
It depends. Depends on how much time I have. At festivals, you do have a lot of interviews, and you don't always, because it's sometimes they're just available at in 15 minutes, let's say, and then you don't really have time to prepare. But that rarely happens. And mostly I take about 2-3 hours maybe. I definitely listen to the most recent album that they're promoting. I go into their back catalog a little bit. I just look up other interviews, just see. I do a lot of research, I would say, but I think it's only natural because some artists say that as well. Well, oh, that's really nice. You've done your research. And then my response always is, well, that's my job.
Met mensen van Triggerfinger en de Staat. Dit is een project van Michiel Klaassen. Geef ze een keihard applaus, Limburg. Hier is Stonsky!
Because you don't really get a nice studio setting to do those interviews. You have to be, you just have to grab some chairs or wherever you can find space, usually. Especially even with those press days that I mentioned, usually they put you in the lobby of a hotel, which is terrible in terms of noise and setting up the camera well and stuff. So you have to be a little bit inventive to find a nice place to do it.
Every time I think I got the devil beat, there he comes tapping at my feet. But I'm a child saved, Holy Ghost filled. You can try and try, but I'm in his will. Keep a knocking, keep a rocking, keep a knocking. Keep a knocking, but my soul you won't win.
First of all, Michelle, how are you?
I'm doing really well, thank you.
Well, before we talk about the record,
yes,
let's go back a little bit.
Ooh.
Do you remember the first time you knew you wanted to be a singer? Because I believe it came quite late, right?
It came really late. That means I have to tell my age, right? but it came really late. Maybe somewhere in my late 20s. That late.
Do you remember why?
Yeah, I think I just really got tired of doing what I was doing. Or I should say, maybe people got tired of me doing what I was doing because I was working in a hospital.
Okay.
And I was told that I was singing at the desk and I didn't realize that. So I think that was one of the signs, okay, maybe I need to go. but it came late. I wanted to be a dancer, you know, that's what my passion was. Singing was something that you do, you know, Wednesdays, Saturdays, Sundays, you sing in the church. That's, you know, but I didn't take it as being, my profession.
Right.
No, I'm a dancer. But I'm really happy that life took a different turn and, yeah, I'm a singer.
You being like a journalist, do you book your own interviews or is there somebody else that does that?
Especially the last 5 years, I've been doing most of it by myself. But we get approached by a lot of the labels as well. So sometimes they have an artist that they want to push forward, or there's a new album coming out that they want to promote, and they ask, hey, do you want to come by for an interview? Or I'll ask if let's say an artist is playing at the Paradiso, which is a venue in Amsterdam, I would say, okay, are they available for an interview before their show or something? And then
legendary,
we would
place
set it up that way. I would say more than half is kind of offered to me, and then the other half I would request, I think.
That's fun. I love
that. It's fun because, well, you mentioned it earlier with the travel. I think the most fun thing about my job is I get to speak to all different kinds of people from all different walks of life, from all different countries. I mean, I've spoken to metal bands from Bahrain. I mean, just crazy places. You speak to people from Iceland, from the Faroe Islands. It's really interesting.
I saw the one in Lebanon you did. Interesting dude, that one. like living on the edge, but like being creative at the same time.
Spent the last maybe 10 years away from Beirut, being on tour, living in Europe most of the times. Paris was the place of choice because I had family there. But then we would tour Europe the whole year, and I would see Beirut maybe one month out of the year combined. But I knew that I had an unfinished story with the city. Now, all of this was amplified by how much trouble the city went through these last 5 years. In the city, I own a bar.
Okay.
I'm a DJ as well. I play electronic music in the clubs. So I have my hand on the pulse of the city. I see it every day and every night when I go to the bar or to the club.
Get to meet some really interesting people, or get to talk to them for 20 minutes to 30 minutes, and it's very humbling as well, because you just get to pick their brains a little bit and see where they're coming from. And for instance, that guy that you mentioned in Lebanon, I mean, that's not a rock and roll kind of scene that they have over there, so it's kind of trying to figure out how to make his way musically. And he was very inspired by traditional blues and stuff, so him trying to figure out how to play that kind of music in that country, that it's really interesting to hear, and all the things that go along with that.
Tell us about your, because you did study in the U.S. as well, right?
I went to on an exchange. That's part of kind of the American Studies degree. You could go on an exchange, and I did a semester at Eastern Michigan University in Michigan, which is in Ypsilanti, Michigan, which is the hometown of Domino's Pizza.
Oh yeah.
Fun fact, everyone.
It's some trivia for you.
I love that.
How did you like the U.S.?
Yeah,
it was really cool. Because I've been to New York before that, and New York is amazing, but it's not real America the way it's same like Amsterdam. If you go to the center of Amsterdam, that's not representative of the rest of the Netherlands. So once I actually lived in Michigan, and I had a couple of friends, and they took me up to Flint, Michigan, which has this kind of reputation, I suppose, of government failings and everything. And you get to see real America, I thought. That was really amazing. And everybody was so friendly.
I know. They have
a lot of Americans. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
No, they're super nice. Just a lot of nice there Americans.
There have been some silly questions when I was in America, like if we have, somebody asked me if we had paved roads in the Netherlands, that kind of stuff. And I mean, you don't know really how to answer that. But other than that, they were so kind. Even people invited me to their Thanksgiving that I barely knew and stuff. So they're really warm and inviting and nice. And like you said, Andre, I do think they get a bad rap sometimes.
Yeah.
Robin, have you ever interviewed people that were inebriated or drunk and it was a little excessive?
Inebriated, maybe not so much, but. And it's funny because I would expect more people to be stoned because we are in Amsterdam. And it's kind of, especially if you're an artist and you're on the road, you get to smoke some weed legally, all that stuff. So I thought that would be a lot more persuasive. It wasn't that much, but yeah, some do. I mean, and sometimes they become a little bit incoherent. And there have been a couple of interviews I ended up not publishing just because there was no point, because there was no conversation. But
well,
I remember,
them, right?
Yeah, and for us as well, you don't, for both parties, it's just better sometimes to not publish it if it doesn't work. Doesn't happen a lot, and usually if they do, like I have a couple of interviews where they're just smoking a joint while I'm talking to them, but usually then they're such avid smokers that it doesn't really affect them. Or usually a lot of, like, I can remember, what's the guy's name? Paul Kalkbrenner, I think, one of the DJs. He smoked a joint in one of the interviews, but I think he just traveled for 20 hours or whatever, arrived in Amsterdam, and then I had to talk to me. So just to calm his nerves or just calming down a little bit, he smoked and it was just a pleasant conversation. So no, I don't mind it. So as long as they can function, I don't mind it.
Yeah,
exactly.
Do you remember the first band that the two of you bonded over?
Beastie Boys.
Yeah, Beastie Boys.
How come Beastie Boys?
I think there was a couple of reasons why we bonded over the Beastie Boys. It was, well, number one, they were always a band that kind of didn't have any boundaries.
Do you remember the first record that you ever bought?
Yeah, I remember the first album I was ever given, actually, which was a Thin Lizzy album,
Okay.
Thin Lizzy's Live and Dangerous. The first record I ever bought was a single, was a Daft Punk single, for One More Time.
So I will not ask you why you are creeping in some sad way. I already know. I would not ask you where you came from. I would not ask, and neither would you.
Behind the music. We hebben vandaag de gast Berry Hey en J.B. Meijers. Berry Hey, bekend van Golden Earring natuurlijk. J.B. Meijers, bekend van de Dijk en van de Kamerlinnets. Ze hebben samen een album gemaakt, For You Baby, vorig jaar uitgebracht. Ja, we gaan snel kijken naar het nummer wat ze hebben gemaakt met Danny Vera, Blue by You. En daarna verwelkomen we Berry en J.B. in de uitzending.
I feel so bad, I got a worried mind. I'm so lonesome all of the time. Since I left my baby behind on Blue Bayou. Saving nickels, saving dimes. Working till the sun don't shine. Looking forward to happier times on Blue Bayou.
Martin started
yeah,
it.
Yeah, and he started it all the way back, I believe, in 2002 or something. And that was kind of like what you mentioned earlier, just showing up somewhere with a camera and trying to interview people. And that was kind of the beginnings of it. And it went really well, I think. Before I came there, they had a partnership with nu.nl, and which is kind of this prominent Dutch news website. So there were all these people that we work with and clients. But he's been doing this for more than 20 years, I think. Well, the funny thing was when I went there for the interview for the internship, I figured out, or we found out we were both from the same hometown, Hengelo. And we both went to Groningen to study. So there were a lot of similarities in our lives at that point. So it was an immediate click. And he's a really good interviewer. There's some of his interviews that are really worth checking out. And yeah, it just immediately clicked, and it's been really easy ever since in that respect. But we also, like I said, we had to do a lot of things by just the two of us.
It's a sun and a phoenix. It's not a given, but you're a winner.
Qua levensfase was je ook verder met jou als vader geworden. Je had een vrouw toen ook.
En als de plezier weg is,
ja.
Dan is het heel lastig om dat plezier boven te halen.
Lately, the last couple of months, he's been writing his own songs and he's releasing an EP. So,
oh, really?
Not professionally or anything, but he's releasing an EP. So I think music has always been in his heart, and for me,
Right.
it's always been a big part of my life as well.
I was gonna say, when's
You
your
never
album coming out? Windsor.
Oh, I'm never going to release music. I just enjoy playing it. It's just almost meditative.
What do you play?
Oh, I play a little bit of piano. I'm practicing now. I bought this maybe a couple of months ago.
Guitar here.
Nice.
Oh,
nice.
I don't play that much, unfortunately. I played a lot when I was in college, but since I've been working, not so much.
Awesome.
But I do need to play a little bit more. Because I see a nice guitar behind you, Christopher.
Well, yeah, it's pretty cool. It's pretty fun. Yeah, it's too bad we could have gotten Slash to sign your guitar. That would have been cool.
I will say, I interviewed Slash, and he wasn't very pleasant.
Really, eh?
Yeah.
Wow.
He didn't want to shake my hand beforehand. I don't know, maybe he was in a bad mood. Maybe he didn't want to do the interview, which is understandable, but that's just my memory of it. And it's one of the only interviews I was actually nervous for, because he's such a big figure and I used to listen to Guns N' Roses so much. And I can hear it in my voice now. If I listen back to that interview, I can hear how nervous I was.
Yeah, right. It was a good one though, but...
It was all right. I'm a little bit more critical of myself, I suppose.
Yeah. Well, I think you handled it pretty well.
Do you remember a gig you saw when you were younger that had an impact on you on the Sunset Strip?
I think I saw a lot of gigs when I was a little kid. I guess they all had a sort of an impact because I was really fascinated with the whole sort of situation, you know, the setup and everything. But I think the first really impactful rock and roll show I saw once I started playing guitar and all that kind of stuff was the World Music Festival in 1978. In Los Angeles.
Okay, what was it about this?
It was just a two-day festival with a bunch of different bands, sort of like what happens here in Europe, you know. Right. It was like Aerosmith and Van Halen and a bunch of other bands one day, and Ted Nugent and Cheap Trick and a bunch of other bands. I think UFO, REO Speedwagon, you know, just a whole slew of bands. So it was a big event. It was pretty cool. But I'd seen the Stones prior to that, and I'd seen David Bowie, and I'd seen all these folk artists, Joni Mitchell and Helen Reddy and James Taylor and all that stuff, hanging out with my parents.
What are some of your favorite ones that you've done?
So there's been many, and they're all interesting for different reasons. Sometimes you just have a nice click with the person. Sometimes the conversation is really great. One of my favorites has always been 21 Pilots, because we spoke to them relatively early on in 2014, and they weren't as big as they were about to be. And so I spoke to Tyler by himself, and he's a very introspective guy, so it was very philosophical, or not very, but it was a little bit philosophical, and it had some substance, so that was really cool. And then the next year they were one of the biggest bands in the world, and then you continue to interview them, and as I mentioned earlier, you build kind of this relationship and you have this rapport, and that's always been one of my favorites. Just also because they were willing to do the interview, if that makes sense. Sometimes you interview people and they answer in like short sentences or something, and it's like, okay, right, why are we doing this then if you're not really into it? And right, they have always been really kind with their time, and no, 21 Pilots is the one that immediately sticks out for me. First gentlemen, how have you been?
Good, man. It's been, when was the last time we did an interview with you?
Lowlands, maybe?
Lowlands.
You're playing again this year, aren't you?
Yeah.
Yeah, we are.
So that's
so that would have been 15?
Something like that.
Yeah. 16?
Maybe something. Yeah. Something like that.
Yeah, it's been a while.
Time flies,
yeah? Yeah.
So we take the stage, and not that there aren't nights where we're feeling not good enough and that we have to struggle through something, and we use the music to work through something we're going through personally in that moment. Not that that's not happening, but at the same time, there are a lot of nights where we just are really enjoying ourselves because is going exactly the way we planned, and because we know that we deserve to be up there, and it was a long road to get to that point where you feel like you do deserve to be up there and you're good enough to be doing it. And so that's a big reason why we still enjoy it every night.
All right, gentlemen, thank you very much for your time.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you.
Steve, love doing interviews with you, man.
How was Billie Eilish?
Fun. I think I was really impressed by her.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely. And I spoke to her when she was, I think, 16 or just turned 17 or something. So she was still really young. But you could tell she had kind of a maturity about her, and she was determined and just lovely. And her parents were there, so she was under a good supervision and stuff. So no, I really liked her. That's the fun part about this job as well. You then all of a sudden see them explode and become that big.
Yeah.
That's always a sad moment for Face Culture, because that often means we don't get to interview them anymore because they've become too big for us.
But it's cool though.
She was at the Oscars this year. She performed at the Oscars.
Yeah, she's won a few Grammys.
I did watch the Oscars.
She's won how many Grammys now? Like she's doing well. They're unique. You have to give it to her. They're talented. Her brother too.
Oh yeah, but her brother, especially when I spoke to her, he was still writing most of her music, I think. I don't know if he still does, but yeah, definitely. That's interesting, because you did grow up in a very musical, very creative family. And
yeah.
I believe I read somewhere that your parents wrote music as well. So
yeah.
What kind of music did they write?
Well, my mom taught me and my brother both how to write music. And that's pretty much how we learned how to write music. I don't know. I don't know how I would describe it. My mom's sitting over there. I don't know, singer-songwriter kind of thing. Yeah. She's sort of nodding her head.
He was jet lagged. He was tired. He didn't really want to do the interview, but he was professional enough to be decent and just had that conversation with me. And the one thing I remember most from that interview is he told me how much he disliked touring, but that's kind of a big part of the industry these days. That's the only way you really make money in music these days. So he's a studio guy. He just wants to record records in Nashville with all these Nashville legends. And that's one thing that stuck out to me, especially artists of a certain age, they start to kind of dislike touring a little bit. And if they have a family or whatever, they prefer just to make music and stay at home.
Yeah, it gets hard. It gets hard on the road. It looks glamorous, but it's hard on the body, I think.
It's so exhausting. I mean, I haven't done it, but it looks so exhausting. You're just traveling all the time. You don't really get decent food anywhere. It's tricky.
So I had to start practicing it yesterday.
So what goes through your mind then when you're kind of revisiting the chords?
I don't remember even how to play it.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, we probably wrote Shine On Me on a Tuesday and then recorded it that Thursday. Right. And then I did some overdubs, mixed it, but I mean, didn't play it again. Okay. And I don't know, I'm fine with that, you know. It's sort of like creating that thing, and you put it on record, and that's enough.
So, Robin, are you hopeful about the whole music industry moving forward?
Yeah, and I will always be hopeful, and just simply because there will always be kind of a fringe scene of any sort. Whatever's popular, there's always stuff outside it. Like lately, I've been interviewing a lot of metal bands and that kind of stuff. And there will always be really creative people who make amazing stuff. The only difference is the level exposure, and for instance, with those award shows. Yeah, only certain people will be able to access those kind of things. But I mean, for me, that's the fame has never been a big part for me about the music. It's always been about the music and the performance and then just the artistry and stuff. So that will always remain. I mean, whether I do sometimes become that old man and kind of hate a little bit on modern music. I find modern hip hop very difficult to listen to. Even though I grew up with hip hop in the 90s and early 2000s. So it's good that there are technically no gatekeepers anymore for music. Anybody who has talent can put it online and it can gain traction, but yeah, to make money, it's really difficult. I think we noticed that during COVID as well, where certain artists, the bigger ones, they were too big to fail in a way, but all the smaller ones and the venues, they got decimated. So it's a tough industry. It's really tough. I think the music audience, one, is very fragmented because of the internet and TikTok and whatever. You can just stay in your own lane and never listen to music other than what you like. So that's part of it. But also I think, as you mentioned, I think the labels also push certain artists really hard. Like the biggest artists get the most attention, and that leaves little room for people to come into that, because if you look at the top artists, they've been the top artists for a long time, and they will stay those top artists. I don't know. I have mixed feelings about where the industry is going. One day I'm very optimistic. The other day I might be a little bit more.
Do you think there's a resurgence of metal? Because that's what I've been hearing. And I want to know if it's European only, or what are your thoughts on that?
I don't really know, but I wouldn't say a resurgence. I would say it's always been there, but maybe it's maybe it's more appreciated lately, because if you listen to certain metal records, they're very, how would you say this? They deal with very, very tough subjects. And we live in a time now that there's a lot of depression and there's a lot of anxiety and all that kind of stuff. And these songs deal with that. And they can be very cathartic, in the way they are expressed. So I think that's perhaps a reason why maybe more people can find something in metal music these days.
Is there something that's like, oh man, like something's brewing over there, like a scene, something new? Like, do you see anything interesting going around? What's the next big thing?
TikTok, people get very famous very quickly these days. That I will say. Mm. They have millions and millions of followers on social media, and then they struggle to get more than 1,000 people to show up at their shows. There's this really strange disconnect at the moment in that field, at least. But I think, yeah, you see a lot of these TikTok artists pop up.
And in what genre?
Oh, it's always kind of poppy. It's kind of
poppy, yeah.
In the vein of a Justin Bieber, maybe a little bit more modernized, but
yeah.
Okay. A lot of that stuff. I mean, it's just, even the Beatles did the same stuff. I always people give me a lot of hate. Our friends give me a lot of hate for this, but I always say those early Beatles records, they were just poppy nonsense as well. Yeah. I want to hold your hand. I mean, melodically they were amazing, but
they were good. Yeah,
lyrics and all that stuff is.
Yeah.
I like the later Beatles way better. They had more substance, I think.
They evolved, right? They were kids when they started.
Yeah, well, that's true. That's definitely true. And the climate was different. And I think if you compare the musical climate then and now practically everything is possible. I mean, you have the most extreme metal and the most poppy, sexualized poppy music coming out and all that stuff. So the extremes are way bigger, I think, these days. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Eurovision is like it's great this year, eh?
It's kind of this yearly. Is it yearly? I think so.
Or, yeah.
It's the competition, and every country in Europe are the ones that get allowed to participate. They have this artist write a song, and then they compete, and the countries have to give each other points for the song, and then eventually there's a winner. But historically it's always been a little bit, I don't know the right word for it,
political, but more,
no, well, also political, but a little bit cartoony almost in a way. That's not the right word, but it's always been a little bit over the top.
Mm. I mean, so do you become super famous or something, like if you're in it?
And it definitely gives you a boost in popularity, and it gets you to play gigs at all kinds of, it just gives you opportunity, I would say. But yeah. I mean, it depends on what you want to get out of music, I would think. But I also don't want to. I've learned in this job, because I was quite pretentious with my music when I was still in college. Before I did this music, I was like, I listened to Bob Dylan and Pink Floyd, and all this modern music is crap and blah blah blah. But in doing this music and talking to the people who make music that I don't find very interesting, and hearing them speak about it in the same passion that my favorite artists would, and then seeing their true kind of effort that they put in and everything, you can't help but appreciate it. Even if you still don't like the music, you do start to appreciate it a little bit more.
Yeah. Right. You think about the music out of England. I just find like that's the place in Europe, like some really good music is coming out of. And they're not necessarily big in North America or the world, but like,
yeah, that transition has always been difficult for British artists, I think, historically.
But it's good. There's some good stuff there, man. I'm always amazed, actually.
Yeah, you have these people in the UK, I think, that for some reason kind of grab, or I have their finger on the pulse and grab the attention of youth culture or whatever. I mean, yet Oasis, that was really big in the 90s. You have this guy in Scotland now. His name is Gary Cinnamon. It's just a guy with a guitar, a loop pedal, just plays relatively simple music. But he talks about his experiences as a Glaswegian. And for some reason, it managed to connect. And he speaks in his kind of dialect and everything. And it just managed to capture the attention of so many people, the youth culture, and everywhere he goes, it's just him on stage, but there's stadiums full and people with torches, and it's crazy. You should look it up on YouTube. It's really interesting.
I'll look it up.
So I think you have a lot of those type of artists, and you have that whole kind of punk, the post-punk scene that's popping up with bands like Idols and stuff. So but they're Irish, but... The Irish don't like it if you call them part of the UK. Yeah. I will say this quickly, because a lot of people, when I say that I work in music, think that I know a lot of bands or I'm aware of everything that's going on. I know a lot about the people that I interview,
right?
And kind of, but it's ridiculous how many albums come out every week, how many musicians there are, how many bands there are. There's no way
it's to insane keep
track of all of it. So yeah, it's really.
No, not at all. Well, Robin, it's funny because when I was younger, I worked at HMV. Okay. And every Tuesday we got new CDs, and I would have a pile of the CDs that I didn't know where they went. So you classify them metal and jazz or whatever, right? And the pile that had the unknowns that I had no idea where they went was always like a big pile. Every week, bands I never even heard of. I'd always go see the manager. What the hell is this, right?
Yeah.
It's kind of funny. So, yeah, just to add to your point that there's so many bands coming out all the time, and you're like, wow, so much.
I think that's true for every form of entertainment. There's so much out there these days. I mean,
yeah,
it's very, very... I mean, that's kind of the question for a lot of companies, right? How do we get people to watch our stuff? How do we get attention to what we are doing? And that's the most difficult thing now, because there are so many different ways people can entertain themselves, and so many platforms and everything. So like you said, I think that the shorts, I mean, the attention span, I noticed it in myself. Even my attention span has gotten a lot shorter over the years, I think. It is changing, but the long, you see it with podcasts, the long form will still be relevant.
Yeah.
I don't know in what form, but
exactly. That's what makes it interesting now, I think, like, is these long form formats, so you can actually get to know somebody.
Yeah, but
I like
then
it.
The audience will need to have the patience to sit through an interview of 30 or 40 minutes, and especially I think young kids these days, I don't know, I don't have any children, maybe some of you can speak on that a little bit better, but I don't think a lot of, especially like the 12, 13, 14 year olds, that they're not going to sit down. Like our main audience is guys in their 30s, I think.
Okay.
30s, 40.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Interesting.
The things we do for love.
It's all the things we do for love. It's all the things we do for
things we do for love still burning in my blood. The things we do for love. But baby, I got only one.
I will make a quick joke at Andre's expense. Where he lives, that's not officially the Netherlands.
Yeah,
that's funny.
Oh my goodness, that's hilarious.
It's like living
It really is. If I go to Friesland, and it depends on where you go, obviously, but it's almost like you're in a different country.
Yeah, it's different here. People are different, that's for sure.
If I don't speak the Frisian language and that accent, I mean, I can understand only half of what they say. That they have very different kind of customs and stuff than we do. So it's always fun.
Yeah, definitely.
Cool.
Yeah, the Netherlands is diverse. Like, how is it different your hometown to Amsterdam, for example? You know, you're in the farm areas and all that. It must be kind of similar to Friesland in some ways, right?
I would describe it as such. People in the city often dislike people in kind of the country, and they call them farmers or like simpletons or whatever, hillbillies. And the other way around, people in this part of the world, they don't like people in the big cities because they're pretentious and assholes or whatever. Mm-hmm. And I've noticed it's very similar, the type of people that you have. The only thing is that when you're in a big city as Amsterdam, it's just amplified. There's more.
Yeah.
There's just more of everyone.
It's a different beast here, there, I find. Yeah.
Here you have maybe one or two eccentrics because it's a small town and there's not that many eccentric people walking around. It's very kind of social control in a way because it's a small town. But then if you go to Amsterdam, you have the similar type of people, but there's just more of them. There's more eccentric people, and then you notice them more easily, I think. So I don't see a big difference. I mean, it's such a beautiful city with the canals and stuff. I mean, it's
an onion.
I still miss it walking around there. Yeah. I used to do it all the time. Right.
The outskirts is where you see, like, you know, the real Amsterdam. And yeah, I'm always impressed.
The beautiful side of Amsterdam as well.
Yeah. Lots of nice parks.
I mean, I would recommend any tourist who goes to Amsterdam, I mean, do your little kind of tour through the obvious spots like the red light district, the Dam Square, all that stuff. Do that type, but like Andre said, go outside of that as well. And there's so many beautiful parts of Amsterdam that I think a lot of tourists don't get to see. And they're much more relaxed because they aren't that crowded. They aren't overpriced as much.
You hear the Dutch language.
Well, I don't mind. I've never minded that because my English is decent enough, I would say. That I always enjoyed speaking English as well. I mean, I don't do it on a daily basis as much. So my English has suffered a little bit, but I don't mind. I like speaking English.
Yeah. Well, it's
easier to find the words, I find.
It's the language that kind of unifies the world in many ways.
It's
I think.
Good language to speak if you're a journalist, certainly.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, rapid fire questions.
Do rapid fire?
Okay, all right. Two choice questionnaire, city or countryside?
City.
Groningen or Amsterdam?
Amsterdam.
Club or concert?
Ooh, concert, definitely. I don't go clubbing anymore. That's long in the past.
Analog or digital?
Analog.
Rock or punk?
Rock.
Mozart or Bach?
Can I say Beethoven?
Yeah. Slash or the Black Keys?
Ooh, that's a tough one. Slash.
First thing that comes to mind. Canada.
All right. Syrup.
Canada?
Yeah, maple syrup.
Oh, maple syrup. U.S.
Guns.
England. The Netherlands.
I don't know. Cheese. It's those are the very standard things.
Yeah. Okay. EU.
Failing.
UFOs.
Non-existent.
Bitcoin.
Has potential.
Comfort food?
Ooh, I always like pizza, always.
Okay, favorite band?
I don't have a favorite one, but I think the best band in history is Pink Floyd.
Good pick.
Nice one.
This is why we get along so well.
I can elaborate. There's two, because we mentioned the rock music, there's two bands that I think are epitomize rock and roll for me. One is pure rock and roll, which is AC/DC, which is kind of the simplest kind, but they only play the same three chords every song, but it works, and just because the way they play it and the way they perform it. And then the other side of rock and roll to me is the more in-depth, more substantive Pink Floyd type music that really takes you on a journey and stuff.
Nice.
I love it.
But I will say that they aren't necessarily my favorite bands. Like I love listening to Bob Dylan, Jimi Hendrix. Gary Moore is one of my favorite guitarists.
There's so many. Definitely a rock guy.
Oh yeah.
What's your superpower, you think?
Superpower. I don't have a big ego. I think that helps with this job.
Yeah.
I think because we had a couple of interns, and you do notice some people within this industry, they like being around showbiz, and they like kind of the glitz and glamour of it. And I'm very, very, I want to say simple. I'm a simple person. So I don't get excited too much, or I don't get my ego inflated easily.
Yeah, you're humble, dude. And you don't. I remember at Bitcoin, you didn't care who the hell they were. I remember. No. Me either there, but yeah.
Well, one thing you notice when you start interviewing people, and especially interviewing people you've seen on TV before, is that, I mean, it's so cliche and obvious, but that they're just normal people. Everybody is. Everybody's just a person, and that's their job. That's what they do.
Yeah.
So I remember my first interview ever for this company was with Joe Bonamassa, this great, great blues guitar player. And he just seemed like such a normal guy. He was like a little bit shorter than I was. And he was just very, very normal. And that kind of immediately said, okay, there's no big hullabaloo here. It's just people.
Cool.
Yeah.
I
love He's that.
Just people.
Awesome, man. Yeah.
Yeah.
So what's paradise?
Do I have to believe in paradise?
Well, your paradise, I guess. Like, what's your
my paradise?
Or what makes you happy? Or
simple things, like the small things. I can get really happy by just listening to a song, or if the sun shines and you're walking out. I like the little things. I mean, it's very silly, but I, like I said, I don't get excited or about things a lot very quickly. So I like the little things. If the weather's nice, that's makes me happy, and I can go for a walk, and I'm not really bothered by too many people. Those simple things I like.
And last one, your biggest lesson that you learned.
It kind of ties into what I just said, with the fact that everybody's people, and like I speak to people from all over the world, and they all have the same things, the same struggles with love, all that kind of stuff. They write millions of songs about heartbreak and all that kind of stuff. It doesn't matter where you're from, doesn't matter what kind of music you make. The core principles of human existence are very similar, I think. So it makes it a lot easier to navigate all the nonsense that is in journalism these days about all the politics and all that stuff. If you just look at the humanity of us, then you can figure it out, I think.
Yeah, man. Well, thanks a lot, Robin, man. We won't take more.
Thank you guys so much. I hope it was okay.
It was awesome.
Thank you for inviting me.
Yeah, it was really great. Very insightful. Very insightful.
It was good to
see. Thank you.
Good to see you again.
Yeah, I hope.
Yeah,
you would have be to... nice if we can do this in person at some point.
Yeah. Well, and also you have to come down
next year.
In the spring, come visit the studio here.
I haven't been up there for a very long time, so we need to hang out.
Yeah, man, for sure.
That's good.
All right.
Take care, bud.
See you later, bud. See you, Robin.
Thanks again, man.
Bye, Robin. Nice to meet you.
Cheers, bud.
Bye.
That was awesome. Wow.
That was fun.
Freaking awesome.
So fun.